is going to be on the Intel compilers, and I think it's going to have an emphasis on sort of using the compiler as an optimization tool. Our speaker is from Intel, Rakesh Krishnaiyer. Is that close? And so I guess I'll turn it over to Rakesh.
So you can just use these two. So maybe we should start by asking if people can hear you okay.
Sure. Can everyone hear me? Can yes. anyone hear me?
Yeah. I can hear you.
Okay. Is it clear for people on the phone?
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Okay. So I guess we can get started. My name is Rakesh Krishnaiyer. I work in the compiler team at Intel, locally here in Santa Clara. I've been with the compiler group for about 18 years now. So today I'm going to talk about the Intel compiler features, and when the request came to me, it basically asked for a user-driven view of how to use a compiler to analyze and for performance analysis and figuring out opportunities to improve performance. So a lot of the focus today is on the compiler optimization reports, and if you can figure out what the reports tell you, and along the way I have a whole bunch of examples that I will use to demonstrate what it is telling you, plus what you can do to steer the compiler towards better optimizations. Please stop me at any point and ask me questions. So my background inside the compiler team, I was the tech lead for the loop optimizer group for a long time, and currently I manage few of the core optimization groups like the code generator, the scalar optimizer, and the mic offload teams. I'm also the technical architect of the mic compiler inside the compiler team. So let's get started. Okay, so this is a one-page summary of what I would like to present. So basically, the emphasis is on figuring out what the compiler optimization reports are telling you. And it, if you can read it carefully and if you understand what's going on, that can help a lot, because it tells you, it gives you a good idea of what was done by the compiler, and sometimes more important, what was not done by the compiler. And in many cases, it's important to understand the interactions between multiple optimizations. For example, functions can get inlined, there may be an OpenMP parallel outer loop, and then you have various loop optimizations kicking in for a loop nest, and then you want to make sure that the inner loops are getting vectorized, or almost all execution in the hotspots happen in vector loops. So the one key point about the optimization reports is that it's entirely based on static compiler analysis, right? So there is no dynamic information available to the compiler itself. So to get the most out of these, usually what you would do is you would run your application under a performance analysis tool, something like a VTune or your own performance tool, and the tool will tell you what are the hotspots, and you can just look at the functions or the loops that are where most of the time is being spent, and that is a good information, and then now you can correlate it with what the static compiler analysis is telling you. And you can go in and study the report in more detail just for the hotspots. The other important point is that the compiler often generates various different versions of loop nests. So if you look at the assembly, or if you just look at the report, you may see the same loop line number appearing multiple times. So it's important to kind of figure out what is the code path at execution time. So the VTune kind of tool can help you with this. Or if you know details about your own application, you can kind of tell, oh, this is this version. I know this version is never going to be executed. This other path is the more important or the interesting path. And that's the way you'll figure out. So once you figure out the hotspot, when you go down and look at the compiler reports, you want to look at the right version of your loop nest and the function. If the function got inline, you want to look at the report for the inline portion, not the function itself. A lot of the compiler loop optimizations are geared for best vectorization. So as we know, most of the current generation places a lot of emphasis on vectorization. So starting from AVX, AVX2, and with KNC, and now KNL, and going forward, even on Xeons, you have 512-bit vectorization. So many things inside the compiler, the phase ordering and things like that, are geared in such a way that we do things early on to enable good vectorization later on. And this will kind of reflect in the optimization reports also. We'll go through examples later. And in many cases, when you see loop optimizations triggering based on the report, you can control some of these parameters through pragmas and clauses and options and things like that. So typically, you may be able to get better in your performance by tuning those parameters in a very fine-grained fashion, and we will see some examples of that. So this is a one-level, one-slide summary of the basic optimization switches that are useful from the compiler and from the application performance analysis point of view. So for Linux, so the most aggressive loop optimizations happen at the O3 level, but even at -O2, which is the default, it already includes a significant level of loop optimizations, including basic vectorization. So O3 gives you some additional things, but in the grand scheme of things, O2 is already pretty good. The advanced optimization flags, such as the -IPO and then the profgen and profuse. So the profgen profuse basically enable profile guided optimizations. It's like the usage model is kind of different, because you have to do first a training, first a compilation with profgen, and then you run the application, collect the data, and then in the later compilation you use -profuse, where the compiler will actually use the information collected from the run, the previous run. And the -IPO basically enables across files, inlining and things like that, optimizations across files. There are various controls that are available to do finer trade-offs between performance as well as accuracy trade-offs. And we also have some of these mega options like -fast. Internally, it boils down to a bunch of these internal options. So for example, the -fast includes IPO and O3, and it also includes -xhost. -xhost means like wherever the compilation is happening, so you basically want to tune for that target processor. That's what the -xhost means. And there is also these two additional options, the -nopregdev and the -fpmodel fast=2. So these are things that are very specific and to floating point optimization. So for example, the pregdev enables optimizations like if you have a divide and the divisor is loop invariant, that can get hoisted out of the loop, and you basically convert the divide into a reciprocal multiply. So that kind of optimization get enabled by the no pregdev. -fpmodel fast=2, if you're using complex data types, then it basically relaxes the IEEE precision requirements, but you may get better performance out of it. So there are various trade-offs here. And then the two options for parallelization, the -OpenMP enables OpenMP, and the -parallel is for our own auto-parallelizer inside the compiler.
Quick question.
Sure.
So was dash fast, for example, on the Xeon 5, compile on the host to run on the mic, then the dash fast should not be used?
So if you use it on mic, on KNC, the -xhost part is not applicable. So this is for Xeon.
So
you can use -fast on mic, and it will work basically targeting KNC.
So it will be, if you use dash fast, it will be equivalent as like the same thing without dash host.
Yes, okay, that's pretty much, yeah. These are some of the other recent target-specific optimizations. So basic, so if you start with the bottom, so the in order to generate good code for KNC, you use minus M mic. In fact, the minus M mic is kind of different because it generates a different object type, right? So it's not compatible with the Xeons. And everything else is for standard Xeons, including the KNL. So the KNL, from the compiler point of view, is just like a Xeon. So all the options and everything will apply to KNL just like it would apply to a Ivy Bridge or a Sandy Bridge or a Haswell. And the basic parameter for tuning for KNL is this minus X mic AVX 512. And there will be a counterpart for the Skylake server, which is minus X core AVX 512. So if you follow the instruction set evolution of Intel, you can see that the KNC had 512-bit vectorization, but the instruction, the vector instructions were kind of different. They were not compatible with any Xeons prior. The prior Xeons didn't have it, and you couldn't run any of the 256-bit AVX and SSE vectorization instructions on KNC. And the KNC is not forward compatible also in terms of the instructions. But the AVX 512 foundation instructions that are present in KNL, they also carry over to Skylake. But KNL also has a few other additional instructions families, such as the conflict detection and the prefetch and the ERF instructions, which are basically the math instructions, which are unique to KNL. And the Skylake server brings in additional capabilities which are not in KNL. And future Xeons may merge these families further. But right now, the minus X core AVX 512 option will tune for Skylake server. And the minus X mic AVX 512 will tune for KNL. And if you want to just focus on the common subset, you can use the minus X common AVX 512. So this would be like for people who want to run the same binary on both KNL as well as the Skylake server when it eventually arrives. The additional options listed here, the minus AX options, they basically ask the compiler to generate a fat binary. So when you use minus AX something, so you can say minus AX, AVX, comma, SSE, comma, mic AVX 512. So all the compiler is doing is that for each target ISA specified in that command line, it would try to generate a optimized version for that. And that decision is based dynamically by the compiler based on whether it is going to be, whether there are any opportunities in a function to take advantage of the particular ISA. So for some functions, you would see these multiple versions getting generated. So for example, if you say minus AX mic AVX 512, there will be a baseline version, and then the other version will be optimized for KNL. And the baseline defaults to SSC2, but you can also change it. So you can say minus AX mic AVX 512 minus X AVX, and then the baseline will be AVX instead of SSC2. So,
question. So I was not sure you mean the three versions, what that means. So if I use, let's say, the AX mic AVX 512 option, the generated binary will run on all these three different platforms.
Yes.
That's what you are saying?
Yes. And okay. At a function level, the CPU will dispatch it to the right function.
So in terms of performance, is there any performance implication for that? So we prefer some compatible operations in instructions instead of something only run on, you know, KNL, and then our login node could be something else like Haswell.
Sure. Definitely, this has huge performance implications, right? So you are taking advantage of the best target instructions in each version. So if you have this this version running on KNL, it will use KNL instructions. If you are running it on Haswell, it will use Haswell instructions. And dynamically, the compiler is generating the FAT binary, and the runtime knows to dispatch it to the right version so that you don't see any fails, because you cannot run the KNL binary on a Haswell, right?
So does it mean the binary has like different passes every time you have if branch to check?
It, that is done at a high level, at a function level, yes. So it's done in such a way that overhead is very small.
Sorry to jump in, but there's quite a bit of background noise on the call. It'd be helpful if people could press mute.
Okay, so let me go further. So the basic opt report information inside the compiler are controlled by these options. So the one unifying option that you need to remember is this minus opt report equals n. And the n is basically the verbosity level.
I'm not quite sure why you have music playing, but could you please mute your phone? Thank you.
And then to enhance the opt report, you can ask for the opt report only for some subsets of the phases inside the compiler. The default, if you don't say anything, is the default is all, basically means that you get information from all the phases, and that's what we really recommend, because that gives you the whole picture. But sometimes that information can be quite verbose, and then if you want to just look at particular phases, then you can control it using this minus Q opt report phase option. The opt report file lets you steer the output towards a particular file or to STDR error or out. And you also have these options called minus vec report n and bar report n. These were supported by earlier versions of our compilers. And in the current compiler, it will basically steer it towards the subset of the opt report that is relevant for the vec or the par or the OpenMP if you do this. So typically, you would want to do this only if you don't want to use the default. The default is all, so you don't have to look at the vec report only. In terms of the compiler phases, basically, we have 9 different phases inside the compiler where you can control at a phase level whether you want to see the information from each of these. The most important ones are this loop, par, vec, and also OpenMP, especially for HPC segments. So we have tried to unify the reporting for these phases in such a way that it is hierarchical, and each of these get fed into the same infrastructure, so it is easier to read and understand. I think I covered all these points at the bottom. So you can control the opt report to emit only certain phases, and you can also control the verbosity level for each phase.
Question. So we have that report option, so we know what kind of optimizations are done, right? Is there any option that allows me to see what the optimized code look like in the source level instead of assembly code and even lower? Can I see the generated code?
So we will show you what we have today in the 15.0 and compiler, which is basically you get some annotations in the assembly. But in the next version of the compiler, actually the 16.0 when the product releases, you will have an option to embed the text report into the sources.
That will be very useful.
Yes, so that is a feature that we are working towards. So I don't have it, any examples of that today, but you should have it by the end of the year.
August, September. Yeah, we need to optimize the code, and that is very good material for us to learn how to.
But remember, it is not going to show you the transformed pseudocode of the loops, what it will do is it will take your source code and annotate the information from the report in line with the source code. So you have to kind of, but it will show you at the source level that what happened at each loop level. But it will not show you the transformed loop, for example.
Actually, transformed loop is with the free code.
Yeah, but that's what we have. So put it that way.
So in the end, you always have to be able to read the assembly code, right? Like to understand what has been done, if you really want to understand.
Well, we'll see examples of that. Hopefully, you don't have to do it. So that's the whole point. We have spent a lot of effort trying to integrate it into these reports, the text reports. We will see some examples. But if you want to know absolutely everything about it, there's no alternative. But a lot of things you can do just by looking at the opt report. And in fact, we get these requests all the time, right? Because as compiler developers, we see a lot of these performance requests. And most of the time, 90% of the time, I just analyze based on the text reports. If you can read it well, that is key. So because I kind of know what's going on. So the key feature that as a user you would want to learn is, what is the compiler telling me by this particular string? If you know that, then you can get a lot more. So the basic optimization levels are controlled in such a way that each higher level is inclusive of the lower level. So the level one, for example, in the vectorization phase, it basically says when vectorization has occurred, it will output a message. The level two will basically give you a message for every single loop that is generated by the compiler in the assembly. So it will say whether the vectorization happened or not, and if it did not happen, why it did not happen. And then the level 3, 4, and 5 gives additional information, more details, and things like that. And every individual phase has similar kind of control for like what they emit at each level. The loop optimization report basically shows the loop nest in a hierarchical manner. So every single version that gets created by the compiler will show up in the text report in this hierarchy. And any message that we emit will have a remark number. So you can get help on that by going to a web page, and it will give you examples of what that means and more details and all that stuff. So we have tried to make these kind of help things and all accessible, and we will not change the numbers and things like that. So it's quite a bit of engineering that has gone into make this whole feature more useful. The other important parts are, like, you get the caller callee information also as available as part of the loop report. So if you have a loop and then there are multiple functions inside that get inlined, so if you look at the loop report, you will get these numbers, so you kind of know where things are coming from. and we have tried to make the messages more actionable wherever possible. So and the another important thing is, like, compiler has its own internal limits. So if the function body is too large or a loop body is too large, it may stop optimizing at some point. So whenever those kind of things that are unexpected from the user point of view happen, we put in a message to show that. And many times you can also get additional information. So here it says, if you're using O2, try O3. If you're using O3, maybe try this override limits flag. So that may get you more optimizations. So these are examples of messages that basically guide you to more actions and how to get better code. The opt report output, if you don't say anything, it automatically goes to a report file. It is not going to go to the STDR, which was our earlier default in earlier versions of the compiler. And if you use the -G, by default, we would put some of this optimization report information as part of the generated object. So the main point of that is we want the external tools to have access to this information outside of the text report itself. And we have a vector tool that is being developed, and it should come in later this year as a product. It's already in the beta phase. And that tool extensively uses the information that the compiler puts as part of the object files to show various messages and details about the vectorization of hotspots and things like that. So this is an example of what we have today. When you compile with -g and generate the assembly listing via the compiler, if you use a -s, you can see for each loop that exists in the assembly, it kind of tells you what is the most important set of optimizations that happened for that particular loop. So here it's saying it's a P loop, this is a kernel loop, and then there's another kernel loop, it says it was interchanged and then vectorized. So, and here it says it's a remainder loop that was vectorized. So this kind of thing is useful if you want to look at the assembly and you don't know which particular version corresponds to what. So with these annotations will help you, and then you can correlate it with what is the executed path that is showing up in the performance tool. So now I'll go through a few of the slides related to vectorization, efficient vectorization. So one key thing that we always want to encourage is to, for all the hotspots to be using the entire vectors whenever possible, right? So when the compiler vectorizes a loop, in most cases, it may generate three loops. So one is what we call the P loop. The most important part is the vector kernel loop. And then the third one is the remainder loop. So what we want is most of the execution should happen in this vector kernel loop. So if a lot of the time is being spent in the P loop or the remainder loop, then that is a problem, a potential problem. So the vector kernel loop is our best performing, like the most optimized version of all the three. And the P loop and remainder loops, they may also be vectorized by the compiler, but even if they are vectorized, they will be less efficient and because like all the loads and stores will become masked because you are not executing the full vector if you are in a remainder loop, and the same thing with the P loop. Also remember that if the kernel loop gets unrolled by the compiler, so first you vectorize it for say 16 wide vectorization, if it's a single precision floating point. 512 bits are available in the vector register, so you use 32-bit data type, so you can do up to 16 of those. And then you additionally unroll that vectorized loop by a factor of say 4 or a 2. What that does is it increases the possible number of iterations in the remainder loop. So suddenly the original remainder loop, if you did not unroll it, can have up to a maximum of 15 iterations. But if you unroll by a factor of 2, the remainder loop can have up to a maximum trip count of 31. So this information is often useful to figure out if you see like the P loop and the remainder loop are getting most of the hotspots. Then you need to look at what is happening in the kernel loop. Is it getting unrolled? And then correlate it with the trip count of the original loop. So in degenerate cases, all the execution will happen in the P and remainder loops. And basically, that is something that we would like to avoid. Okay. So this is a very simple example that I want to walk through the different parts of the optimization report. So you have a simple for loop with a bunch of memory accesses inside. And now you compile it for KNC at basic O2 optimization level. So the generated loop structure kind of looks like this. So you have a P loop before you enter the kernel loops, and you have So why do we do the peeling? The peeling is to align some of the memory accesses inside the kernel loops. So assuming the compiler knows nothing about the alignment of the arrays. So in the previous slide, the compiler doesn't know whether A of 0 is aligned at 64 bytes or not. Same thing with B of 0 as well as C of 0. So it has no information about the alignment of A, B, and C. And if you have aligned accesses, you can get better performance. So what the compiler tries to do is it peels for A, and then it does a versioning, and it checks if the B has same alignment as A. So if then the first kernel loop will have both A and B accesses aligned. The AL64 means aligned at 64 bytes, and the C is unaligned. And in the alternate alignment kernel loop, only A is aligned, and B is not. So there's a typo here. So and you can see that in the kernel loops, both the kernel loops are undoled by a factor of 2. And then once you exit out of the if condition, then you execute the remaining iterations in the remainder loop. So this is what the compiler is doing, and the report will tell you something like this. So the loop report, it starts with a peel loop, and it says A, B, C are all unaligned. And then the peel loop was vectorized by the compiler. And then this is a kernel loop undoled by 2, and the loop was vectorized. And then it says unmasked, unaligned, unit stride loads 1. And then there may be additional messages like that. If you look at the alignment reports, it says that A and B are aligned, and C is unaligned. And it says there is an alternate alignment vectorized loop. It doesn't give the details, because the details will be very similar to this. And then the remainder loop. So the remainder loop still has A aligned, but B and C are unaligned. So if the hotspot analysis using VTune or something like that shows a lot of the time is spent in peel or remainder loops, so now what do? So you want to take a look at this in more detail and figure out how does the trip count of this loop, like what is at execution time, dynamically, what is the trip count of the loop? And if you take into account the vectorization length, how does it correlate with what the compiler generates? So some typical ways you can address this is, like, many times you have blocking happening at an outer level. And if you choose your blocking parameters carefully, you can end up with the inner loops having higher trip counts. So the higher trip count basically means it has to be at least larger than whatever is the vector length. It doesn't make sense to have a innermost trip count of 8 if you are using single position floating point and running it on KNC or KNL, because it can support up to 16. So if you're using 8, you are basically wasting half of the bandwidth. If you align the arrays yourselves, then the compiler doesn't need to do the peeling, and you can tell that to the compiler using these clauses. The hash pragma vector align basically says all the accesses inside the loop are aligned, so you don't have to generate any peel loop. And you can look at the report and confirm that the compiler didn't generate a peel loop if you aligned it manually. Oftentimes, the compiler can do better decisions if it knows the trip count value. So if it just appears as n, it has absolutely no information what the value of n is. And in such cases, the compiler usually assumes a high value of that. So the case that is most interesting is if it is unknown to the compiler, the value is unknown to the compiler, and the dynamic value is small. That is a case where the compiler will get it wrong, because it may unroll by a factor of 2 or a 4, and then most of the execution will happen in peel or remainder loops. So in such cases, you can give this loop count pragma to give that extra information to the compiler. And then you also have all these other controls. So for example, you can say, I don't want to unroll the vectorized kernel. After you do the vectorization, don't do any further unroll. So that can be controlled using a pragma. You can say, I don't want to vectorize the peel or remainder loops for whatever reason. You can say pragma vector unaligned. So either align the array and tell the compiler, or if you don't align it and you don't want to generate the peel version, then you can control it using this pragma vector unaligned, which basically says don't bother generating the peel loop. And you can say no vector to disable vectorization altogether. The last option here is the opt assume safe padding. This is a KNC specific option. All that it does is it gives the, so the KNC microarchitecture has some properties that are not good for compiler optimization. So for example, it doesn't give the memory fault protection for masked unaligned accesses that the compiler likes. So if you have a masked unaligned access, that will become a gather because the compiler doesn't know if the last element of that, the whatever is unaligned portion, if it is going to the next page and that page is not part of the process address space, it will fault. So that is unique to KNC, and basically if you specify this option, the compiler will, when can you specify this option legally? So all you have to do is to pad those arrays by 64 bytes at the end, so that the compiler doesn't have to worry about when it goes out of bounds for that last few bytes, it will still remain in the process address space. That's all the compiler wants to know, to not generate the gathers, but generate low and high instructions.
I'm going to just check if there are any questions on here.
Sure.
And make myself a panelist.
I have one in the meantime. So okay. With your example of the end that is not known at compile time, does that mean that for really getting high performance, you should prevent or avoid any input files? Like, say, suppose you have a research code that reads an input file that's going to read a lot of values that are not going to be known by the compiler. If you could just put a regular routine, or so that the compiler is aware of those values, do you think you will get more optimization from that?
So you have to do this at, the answer is at two levels, right? So ideally, if all the trip counts are known constants, it's great for the compiler point of view. But that's not practical. You are going to have applications that read in files. Many of these things are going to be dynamic, which are determined by various other factors. What is OpenMP, parallelization, and things like that. That you cannot avoid that. So in such cases, you give the extra information to the compiler using the pragma loop count or other means like that. Plus, remember that the problem cases are not the whole space, right? The problem cases are when the n is small dynamically. So that is the key point. So if whatever value you read in from the file, if they are all good enough, like if they are all big enough, then you probably won't see any problems because most of the execution will happen in the kernel loops anyway, because that matches the default assumptions in the compiler. So the key is to find those mismatches and try to correct those.
So there's only one question, which is, can they have the slides after your presentation?
Sure.
So I'll try to post those somewhere. And I'll just leave this sort of to the side here.
Okay. Okay. Did they cover this? Yes. So this is basically the same thing. So ideal for the compiler if all the trip count and the array extents are known statically. So for example, if you can make it a Fortran parameter or a hash defined in C. And in many cases, the application at the makefile level or the configure level or using C++ template magic, you can do this. And if you do this and if your application can actually take advantage of that feature, I would encourage you to do it, because that gives the compiler complete information, and usually the compiler ends up generating better code out of the result. And we have several examples of that. So in real HPC codes, all they did is somehow magically they figured out how to make those inner loop trip counts known to the compiler statically, and magically the performance improves. So this is basically because there are various cost model decisions inside the compiler, like whether or not to peel, what is the unroll factor for the vectorized loop, what will be the prefetch distance when you prefetch. So all these things are based on compiler heuristics of the trip count. And if the trip count is unknown, The compiler is basically going to guess, and in most cases, it is going to guess a large value and make all the decisions based on that. The other important thing is if you have these constant trip counts, not using pragma loop count, but if it is actually a constant, say do I equals 1 to 8 or 1 to 16, the compiler can do even more optimizations, because now the compiler can completely unroll that loop, and that may expose additional opportunities to hoist some things out of the outer loop. So that kind of thing you can never do if you convey that information using a pragma loop count. The pragma loop count is a hint. The compiler will not hold you to fire saying that during the execution the loop count was not 16. It is just a hint. The compiler will just use that as a input to the cost model heuristics. But if it is I equals 1 to 16, then the compiler doesn't have to worry about any other value. It completely unrolls it. It doesn't have to do any versioning. So all that, the remainder loop goes away, the P loop goes away, all these things become much easier, and now the whole body after vectorization, that is amenable to further optimizations. So we have seen cases where that helps. And the earlier case where I mentioned when somebody changed the Fortran parameter to a constant, it's probably because of something like this happening inside the compiler. So this is the second half of that, which is basically that if you cannot make it a constant, if they are variables, then you just try to make the best information available to the compiler, and you can control it. You can pass the information using a loop count pragma, or look at what the optimization decisions are, and then maybe control it using the unroll zero option. Maybe if you don't want the P loop, and you know that most of these accesses are going to be aligned anyway, then you put in the correct alignment clause for the loop, per loop. Like if you say hash pragma vector aligned in front of a loop, that's like a blanket guarantee that says the first touch to each of the array accesses inside that loop is aligned. And the compiler is not going to do any checking. It's just going to trust that and then generate aligned instructions for those cases. But in some cases, that is not possible because you don't know the properties of all the arrays, and then you would want to control it on a per array basis, and you can do that using various alignment clauses. You can also use the prefetch distance option to fine tune for low trip count loops. So we'll see some examples later on. In some cases, when you have these low trip count loops, you may want to also consider whether it's better to vectorize at an outer level, which may be possible, and it can take advantage of the full vector length instead of just vectorizing at the inner loop. So the bottom line is the opt report, if you are able to read it carefully and understand what's going on, it may give you further clues on what to do to get better performance. Okay. This is an example of cache blocking. So the cache blocking is important for all these processes, right? Because we have these big caches, and in order to take advantage of them, what we want is to do some kind of cache blocking. So, for example, this is an n-body calculation on the left, and the code in red basically shows you how it is getting blocked at the higher level, and then you are doing the two-level inner loop, which is working on the innermost loop working on the block that is defined by the outermost loop. So the right hand shows you the actual source code of a kernel that is doing this kind of n-body calculation. And you can see that the outermost loop is getting parallelized using OpenMP, and the chunk size is large, it's like 8K. And then you are doing this is the pragma OpenMP for loop, and you have an inner loop, which is a J loop, and then the I loop is getting parallelized using OpenMP. If you look carefully, this pragma unroll and jam, so we'll see an example later on that shows what that means, but this is a pragma where you can basically control, fine-tune the loop optimization done inside this loop nest by, like, the unroll and jam basically means unroll the outer loop by that factor, and then jam all the multiple inner loops into a single for j loop. So you would see so you will get this xj, input position x of j, and then the input position x of I, right? So the j axis can get repeated, the same value is getting reused by the multiple I iterations. And that is what you are taking advantage of when you see this unroll and jam. So this kind of thing is common, like for example, matrix multiply does this, where the unroll and jam. So you want to, the ideal situation is you would have some kind of application cache level blocking at the high level, and then you have a parallelization of an outer loop and a vectorization of the innermost loop, and maybe there is some opportunity for loop optimizations like unroll and jam at the intermediate loop level or the outer loop level, okay? So this is an example that shows a few things. So one is this data dependence multi-versioning done by the compiler. So in many cases, the compiler is not able to vectorize loops because it doesn't know the dependence between whether A and B overlap or whether A and C overlap, right? So you can, and the compiler tries to handle it at runtime by generating multiple versions, and you can see it here. So what the compiler does is it does a runtime versioning to see if there is any overlap between the store versus the loads and across the entire trip count of the loop. So that kind of check, if it passes, then it goes to this version one of the loop, which is nicely vectorized. If that check fails, then you go to the version two of the loop, which is not vectorized, okay? So ideally, there is no dependence and the execution goes to the multi-version one, and which is now, because of the align, hash pragma vector aligned, non-temporal, you can see that all the axes are basically saying it's aligned, and the non-temporal leads to a streaming store instruction on KNC. Basically, that helps the bandwidth on KNC. So, because you are not going to do the read, modify, write, you avoid the read because you know that you're going to write the entire cache line anyway. So the important property for that is that the store has to be aligned and unmasked, and it has to be writing to the entire cache line. And which is what you are, and that's what you are asserting by saying the hash pragma vector aligned, and you are saying it's non-temporal, so use the streaming store instructions. This is another example of things that we see typically in a lot of these legacy codes. So many loops are hand unrolled by some arbitrary factor, by 2 or 4 or 8 or something like that. But this kind of thing is not helpful to the compiler. In fact, the compiler has to undo whatever is done in the source before it can properly optimize that loop. So the key message is that if you can rewrite the loop in this way, it's much better than rewriting it as what shows up in the left. Because if you want to vectorize the loop nest on the left, and the vector length is say 16 or 8, all of these, if you do a naive vectorization, all of these will become gathers and scatters because these are all strided accesses. What you want is unit stride accesses. So in order to, so the simple cases like this, the compiler will do the right thing even if you give it whatever is on the left. Because internally what the compiler is doing is it is re-rolling this loop, rewriting it to this form and then vectorizing it. But that is possible only for simple cases. So consider a case where you have, like, instead of each version being a single line, like say 4 lines or 5 lines, and then those 4 lines are repeated 2 times or 4 times or 8 times inside the loop body. The compiler is not going to be able to handle those kind of things. So those are the cases where you want to do it, rewrite it in source to make it simpler for the compiler. The compiler really likes to see and vectorize using unit stride accesses. And that is, if you can do that for all your hotspots, the vectorization will do very well. That's very important. Whenever that is possible, you should try to do that. In many cases, it's not. But if it is not, it should be for a real reason, not for some trivial reasons like this, wherever possible. This is an example that shows the interchange and vectorization interaction. So you have a loop nest that is highlighted in purple from lines 159 to 169. And the value of NP happens to be 16, and that is known to the compiler in this particular case. And if you look at the transformations that are done for this loop nest, I can explain it to you first. So what ends up happening is that the compiler distributes this do n do m loop into, like, you stop the div mn equals 0, that becomes a two-level loop nest separate, and then you have a three-level loop nest of n m j that is basically doing this div mn calculation. So the first part is shown here. So the first loop nest, which is basically doing this equal 0, that gets converted into a simple call to memcopy, to memset inside the compiler. So and that goes to our library version of memset, which is optimized and everything for the based on the taking advantage of the particular target ISERs. And then the next half, which is basically this three-level loop nest, the compiler is doing an interchange. So it says 1, 2, 3 converted to 1, 3, 2, which basically means that this NMJ loop got converted to NJM loop. So the J came in the middle and the M got pushed all the way in. And then that the permuted loop was vectorized, and then the maximum trip count after vectorization of that loop is 4, because the loop got vectorized with a vector length of 4, and then the original trip count was 16, and so the maximum trip count is 4. This kind of information is useful to the compiler, because if it decided to do any prefetching for this loop, now it knows that the trip count, maximum trip count, is 4, so it will pick a distance like 2 or 3. It will not pick a distance of 8. Because if you do choose a distance of 8 and the trip count is only 4, most of the prefetches are going to be useless. So this is exactly same example. The only change was that the original user source had these I, J, K, L, M, N variables as part of the module. So this causes trouble to the compiler. Compiler doesn't want to see these loop induction variables as globals. They want to see it as local, because if it is global, what that means is you have to keep track of the final values of those after the loop. So that destroys the perfect nesting of the loop, and that in turn disables things like loop interchange and unroll and jam, and it makes things harder for the compiler. So it actually prevents loop interchange. Unroll and jam we can still do, even if it's an imperfect nest. So yeah, and if you look at the report for this particular loop nest, it will say something like this: loop interchange not done due to imperfect loop nest in the compiler. So this is another thing that we have seen from real application codes. So some of these old legacy Fortran code have these things in modules which even cover loop induction variables. If you can just get rid of those, you might see better performance. And that's because it impacts compiler loop optimizations. So please take a look if you have things like that. Hopefully, if you make them local, nothing changes in the application. And in most cases, they are not relying on those being global. It is just the way of coding that they made it. And once you put it as global, the compiler has to basically obey that. It cannot just make them local automatically. This is a MATMUL example in C on the left. So the original loop nest has this 4 J I K, and after transformation through the compiler, it looks something like this on the right. So you have this outer two loops being converted to a mem copy. I mean, I should have said mem set. Sorry, it's a mem set, and then the J K I loop, it actually gets blocked, and then the outer loop two loops get unroll jammed, and then the innermost loop gets vectorized. I've not shown the outer three level blocking, but the unroll and jam is shown. So if you see, both the J and K loop are unrolled and jammed by 4. So you will see all these J plus 1, K plus 1, up to J plus 3, K plus 3 inside the loop. And there is only a single inner I loop. That's the jamming part. So you have basically unrolled the outer loop and jammed everything into a single loop. That's the unroll and jam transformation. And you can control that parameter using a hash pragma. So whenever you see unrolled jam reported by the compiler, you can check, like, you know, if change the parameter. Maybe changing the parameter from 2 to 4 will give you additional gains. Maybe the unroll and jam that's being done by the compiler, turn it to 0 and see if it actually hurts. So if any time you turn off some optimization, it hurts, that basically means that you can fine-tune that particular optimization and get more performance. So this is the basically how the report will look like for this particular matrix multiply example. So I'm compiling with O3 for KNL, and it shows the first part, which is basically a mem set, and then the compiler collapses the first two deep loop nest and then converts it into a mem set. So somewhere along the way, one of the loop gets eliminated as part of the collapsing. And then the second distributed chunk, we do the interchange, and then you have the blocking and unroll jam at the two outer loop levels, and then the innermost loop also gets vectorized in addition to getting blocked. And this is the remainder portion. So whenever the compiler does this block, does the unroll jam, for blocking you don't need a remainder, because the way we do the blocking, we set the upper bounds correctly. But for the unroll jam part, you have to do the remainder. So there are two remainder loops. So the unroll jam is basically, it's in the literature, it's also called register blocking sometimes. So all you're trying to do is to keep things in registers, so that you get more reuse. It's just like doing the cache blocking. The cache blocking you are doing at the for the caches, and the unroll and jam you are doing it the same concept, but to keep things in the register. So this is a list of the some of the pragmas that you can use to fine tune things. So many of these loop transformations can also be suppressed. So whenever you see something's reported by the compiler, you can use either a pragma or an option to suppress things. So the first example here is the pragma SIMD reduction. So the SIMD is kind of special in that it is basically the counterpart of the OpenMP parallel applied to vectorization, right? So whenever the compiler sees a pragma SIMD, it basically will treat the loop as is. It will not touch that loop any further. So for example, if you put a pragma SIMD on the innermost loop, that will prevent interchange of that loop with an outer loop, because the pragma SIMD says, I want to keep it as is. So in some cases, that is the best way. If you don't like some transformation being done by the compiler, all it takes is putting a pragma SIMD on the innermost loop, and that would disable a whole bunch of other loop transformations that are happening around it. The loop count syntax looks like this. You can specify a minimum value, maximum value, and an average value. And the syntax for the Fortran doesn't have the underscore. You can use the pragma vector align, non-temporal, and there are some other clauses also. And then the no vector will suppress the vectorization. The unroll factor you can specify using this unroll pragma. And remember that the unroll factor gets applied after vectorization if the loop got vectorized. So if it got vectorized using a vector length of 8, the unroll factor will apply on that vectorized body. And if the loop is not vectorized, it'll be unrolled. The scalar loop will be unrolled. Similarly, the pragma unroll and jam. So you can use pragma unroll and jam 0 to suppress the unroll and jam, or you can give a factor. Pragma no fusion will disable loop fusion. So the loop fusion is an optimization that we currently do only under O3. and that gets suppressed using the Pragmatic fusion. The distribute point is if you want to control fine level where the distribution should happen inside the loop, you can put the pragma distribute point at that point wherever you want the distribution to happen. And if you don't like the distribution that is being done by the compiler, just put it at the top of, like, as the first statement inside the do loop or the for loop. You put the hash pragma distribute point. That will disable any distribution done by the compiler. If you put a force inline pragma right about a call, so you have a loop, and inside the loop you have a call to some function, you stick in this pragma right about that call statement, that call will get recursively inlined if you have the recursive keyword.
And if you don't do that, there's a chance that your call function won't be inlined, right?
Yeah, then you are basically leaving it to the compiler heuristics. Then it's determined based on what is the optimization level, is it IP, IPO, and
why, in which case you don't want inlining? Like in most cases, you want inlining, right?
There are a lot of cases where you don't want inlining also, right? First of all, if you're going to expand the body of the function terribly, and inlining is kind of like, think of a loop, and you have a function call inside the loop. If you're able to, the right way to vectorize this loop, if the function body is small, you can inline it and then vectorize it. But if the function body is complex, with multiple while loops and for loops and things like that, if you just blindly inline it, you're basically losing vectorization of the whole thing. The right way to do it is to make this function be a SIMD enabled function. So we'll see some examples of that later. What you want is to create a vector version of that function and then vectorize a loop so that the compiler can call the vector version of that function inside every vectorized iteration. So this is achieved by OpenMP 4.0 as well as our own syntax, the Silk Plus syntax. The OpenMP 4.0, you would say dickle spec OMP declare SIMD on the function. So that tells the compiler to generate a vector version of that function. And then in the loop, you would put hash pragma OMP SIMD, I want to vectorize this loop. These two will get you what you want.
What is the distribute point?
Distribute point is the loop distribution optimization. So the examples that we saw in the matrix multiply where an outer loop, several levels, it got distributed at some point. So basically breaking a big loop into two loops. So do I equals 1 to n and you have S1, S2, S3, n do. When you do distribution, it can do I equals 1 to n, S1, n do, and then again start do I equals 1 to n, S2, S3, n do. This is an example of distribution. So even in Fortran, which is friendlier to the compiler compared to C and C++ because it doesn't have the pointer, everything could be a pointer, you could have a random overlaps in C. Fortran gives us a lot of...
Excuse me, yeah. Can you read the title? That thing covers the stuff?
Stride.
You need stride.
Stride is important.
Yeah, I don't know how to move this.
I probably can't remove that message about it. Yeah, you are sharing.
Well, I think you can move it to that right.
Hold on.
That might be the best we could do. Hold on. Oops, sorry. I changed your slide. Apparently, it can only move across the top.
Not down. Okay.
Oh, sorry.
You can ask me, I will tell you.
Okay. So even in Fortran, it's important to get the innermost loops vectorized with unit stride. So there are a lot of different kinds of arrays that you can use in Fortran. Many of these have language semantics allows the compiler to use nice unit stride vectorization, for example, allocatables and adjustable arrays, explicit arrays, assumed size arrays, and things like that. But if you have, but even in these cases, it is important to have the vector loop index to be in the last dimension. So here is an example. If the original source is such that the loop index is not the at the leftmost end, which is the fastest changing thing in Fortran, if you don't have that, then basically what you get is not unit stride vectorization. And you can use a F90 array notation to change it to something like this and get unit stride vectorization. So when the algorithm allows it. In many cases, it's possible and you can get the benefits like that. If you have F90 pointers or assumed shape arrays, they basically get strided access based on the language semantics. But if you know that all the call sites are such that you're going to basically have the accesses unit stride, whenever you pass an assumed shape array, the stride is going to be unit, then you can actually use this Fortran 2008 support for the contiguous attribute. And if you specify that attribute on your assumed shape array, right out of the front end, the compiler will see a unit stride. And then it'll be like all nice vectorization for the rest of the compiler. So if it is possible, take a look and apply this attribute to your assumed shape arrays and pointers. This is another example where sometimes you want to look at not just the innermost loop, but the vectorization at an outer level to get the best performance. So you have a multi-dimensional array, and sometimes it's not, it also requires user help. So this is an example where there's a K loop, and then this temp statement is basically F90 array statement, which is a loop, right? And if you vectorize that statement alone, you can do that. But the problem is that NC value is like 2 or 12. So you're not going to get much out of vectorizing a loop with trip count 2 or 12 if you're vectorizing for 16. Then, but the K is nice. But if you want to vectorize at K, you have a problem because the temp accesses and all these accesses are not going to be unit strided. But you look at the application and then this whole thing, you can change it, like, because wherever you're not changing the size of the array, all you're doing is wherever Tij, you make it Tji. If you can do it both at the consumer and the producer level, and it is a localized transformation, in some cases you can do that and you get all the nice properties by vectorizing at the K level, and all you need to do is to put the $SIMD on the outer loop level. So you do this transformation to get, so now you are going to vectorize at the K level. What that means is 4 iterations of the K loop are going to happen at the same time. So even when you reach the inner loop level, you're basically executing 4 K iterations simultaneously. That's what is happening conceptually when you vectorize outer loop. And you want to use the MI and K are basically the unit strided thing, right? So you want to have it at the leftmost level as index. Even if the NC value is unknown, this is still useful. Even if it is like the compiler treats it as a variable, it doesn't know it's 2 or 12 or 12,000, it doesn't matter. Even if you keep it as a variable and vectorize at the outer level, you still get most of the benefits. But you need to do this transformation to change from here to here, from the red to the green. A lot of the HPC codes have indirect accesses, right? The indirect accesses come due to variety of reasons. And many of these things are for valid reasons, and you can do not much to change it. Sometimes you can change the algorithm to make it not use indirect accesses. If you can do that, that'll be great. But here, I just want to go over how does the compiler reason about loops with indirect accesses. So in order to vectorize a loop, the J loop here, basically there is a dependence on the XD array, right? So the index is coming from a load of SES of J. You could have index values that are the same across a 16 window of iterations, which is basically what we are going to vectorize using a single instruction. So the key requirement is that the indices have to be distinct. If not, you could get data races. It is incorrect program if you do vectorization. The compiler will vectorize it for you if you stick in a SIMD pragma for that J loop. But it is implicitly assuming that the indices are distinct. Now, we will see how this kind of a loop can be vectorized without making that assumption on KNL. That is this V conflict, which we'll come to a little bit later. So when you vectorize using a SIMD pragma, the algorithm tells you that all the index values are distinct and you can vectorize it without worrying about data races. But even when we do that, the compiler is going to use gather scatter based vectorization because it's an indirect access. And whether the gather scatter helps compared to scalar will depend on things like, what is the cache locality for the indirect accesses? Are they all going to the same cache or are they going to 16 different cache lines? This is all based on the data dependent, right? What are the values of indices for the 16 lanes of the vector? And whether all this data, whether even if they are going to different cache lines, are they in the cache or are they coming from memory? So if they are coming from memory, then you have to have all, you may have a memory bandwidth issue. So, and then you may want to think about whether the prefetching is happening for the indirect accesses correctly. And if the true bottleneck is memory, fine control changes in the how you do vectorization may not really matter, because whether you use gather scatter or with a fewer instructions, it doesn't really matter. Because the bottleneck is elsewhere. And the other important thing is, like, the typical case where you want to vectorize even with gathers and scatters, the typical case where you get gains from that is when you have a lot of other computation inside the loop, like costly computations like divide, square root, a call to a sine or a cosine or exponent or a power. All these will get much faster because you're doing 16 at a time, even though you are doing some of the loads and stores using gathers and scatters. You are amortizing the cost by doing the computation in parallel in a vector register. So there are all these considerations that determine whether or not you're going to get a gain from gather scatter based vectorization of loops with indirect accesses. So now we'll talk about the KNL specific support for this, improving this particular case of indirect accesses. So the sparse computations that does a typical histogram computation looks like this. And if you do a naive gather scatter, you will generate something like what is in this box, but the code is wrong, as we said earlier, because the values of B, if there are duplicated values, then the code generated is wrong. So you can do this correctly only if there is a SIMD pragma, which basically says that there are no duplicates in the BI values. But now we have these additional instructions in KNL, which is part of the AVX512 CD conflict detection instructions available both in KNL as well as in Skylake. You are able to generate code something like this. So all you want to do is, instead of doing all the 16 elements at a time, you want to pick the subset which are non-overlapping indices and then do it. So for example, out of the 16 values, there is only one duplicate. The 15 ones are unique and only one duplicate. And you have this do while loop. Hardware determines, like, it picks the non-overlapping subset. And it will be done in a couple of iterations, because 15 of them will happen once, and in the next iteration, one more will be done. So this is something better than not vectorizing at all. So this is new instructions that are available in KNL, not in any earlier process, not even in KNC. So the compiler, for the earlier case, for this loop, the J loop, if you use the KNL option, it gets vectorized like this. So it says there's a, it gives you an indication that it's a histogram computation. It gets the vector length 16, and then you can see this inner loop. This is basically the do while loop that is getting generated as part of the original loop in the source. Inner level versus outer level vectorization. So we saw an example of outer loop vectorization already. So this is probably saying some of the same things. So when to consider outer loop vectorization? If the inner loop trip counts are low, that is a case that you may want to consider whether it makes sense to vectorize at an outer loop level. Are there any expensive operations in the outer loop? So now if you are vectorizing at the outer loop level, you are vectorizing all the instructions that are outside the inner loop but inside the outer loop. So if there are like divides and square roots in that portion, you can get benefits by vectorizing at the outer loop level. And then you have to look at the loop level that you are vectorizing and then look at what it will do to the loads and stores. So if you are vectorizing at the outer level, the unit stride pattern will look one way, and if you change it to the same loop nest and vectorize at the inner loop level, some of the unit stride things in the outer loop vectorization will become gathers and vice versa. So these are the different trade-offs that you need to make, and sometimes you can force these outer loop vectorization using the SIMD pragma. The compiler, if you give it enough hints of the trip counts and things like that, it can try to do this outer loop vectorization decisions by itself. But in most cases, it's much easier and better to control it using explicit pragmas, either the OpenMP SIMD pragma or the pragma SIMD in surplus. So how to do the outer loop vectorization? The right way to do it is, like, if you can do it using a SIMD pragma or a OMP SIMD directive, you can do that. The other thing is the one that we talked about earlier, where you have a call inside the loop, and you basically you want to put all that body of the outer loop into a function, and then use the SIMD pragma at the loop level, and then just call the SIMD enabled function. The third way is to change each statement of the loop body to operate on a strip. So we'll see an example later. This is using the Silk plus array notations. You can do a similar thing on Fortran. So this is the outlining into an elemental function or a SIMD enabled function. So on the left hand side, you have a simple two-level loop nest, basically doing a sparse matrix vector computation, right? So you have a row loop and a I loop. So if you vectorize at the inner loop, so the typical problem with the sparse matrix vector is that the I loop, the representation is such that the I loop trip count will be very small because the matrix is sparse, right? So you want to consider whether you can vectorize at the row loop and get real gains from vectorization. So if you do the inner loop vectorization, the A coefs axis will be unit strided, and the A codes axis will be unit strided. The local X axis will be gathered, and the local Y storage, it's anyway doing loop invariant thing, right? So it will get moved out of the inner loop anyway, so you won't see the loads and stores for the local Y inside the inner loop, inside the vectorized loop. The compiler will do that for you. On the right-hand side is where it shows how you can turn this into an elemental function, right? So now you are trying to vectorize the row loop by putting the pragma SIMD on top, and then the inner loop basically becomes a function, and you are declaring it as a vector using this decal spec vector. And the most important thing is to have these right clauses applied for this vector declaration, the function declaration. So what you are basically saying is that the arrow of all the base pointers, they are not changing across the lanes. The only thing that is changing is I. It's this row, because you are vectorizing at the row level, right? So at the call site, the row is changing by unit. So what all you're saying is that the four vector lanes have consecutive values of for row. So basically row, row plus one, row plus two, row plus three. So you use the linear clause for the row parameter, and all the other array base pointers, you declare them as uniform. If you don't do this, all these accesses inside will become gathers. So you are not going to get any benefit if you do that. So it's very critical that you apply the right clauses for all the parameters. So look carefully at how these parameters will change across the vector lanes at the call site, and apply those clauses for the vector function. And you can specify multiple lines of these. So each decal spec vector line basically asks the compiler to create a vector version of that function. The compiler also generates a scalar version of the function, and it also generates a vector version. And if you have multiple lines with different clauses, for each such variant, the compiler will generate a specialized version of the function. And at the call side, it will look at what are the properties of these variables, and it will call the corresponding function which closely matches it. So for the best performance, if the call site matches these parameters and this gets called, you'll get the best performance. But if anything is not matched, it's not like you are going to get incorrect code, the compiler will just call the scalar version. So this is and this is now part of OpenMP 4.0. So I'm showing the Intel syntax, but the same thing can be expressed using OMP 4.0, so you don't have to worry about standards and things like that. So this is a final control on the prefetch pragmas that's supported by the compiler. So this is very relevant for KNC because the KNC doesn't have it only has a L2 level prefetcher. It didn't have a hardware prefetcher for the L2 to L1. So the compiler prefetching plays a very critical role for good performance on KNC. For KNL, it actually has both a L2 prefetcher as well as an L1 prefetcher, and it's still too early for us to tell how much impact compiler prefetching will give on KNL. But the controls are there for both KNC as well as KNL. So all the prefetch examples in the following slides are specific to KNC. So you can specify a variable and then a hint and a distance. So the hint is basically the prefetch instruction that gets generated. We prefetch 0, 1, 2, NTA. So these are the four different variants that you can generate. And there are the exclusive variants also, which basically says that you're going to do a store of these. So if you say star, that basically means for all the references inside the loop, use this hint and use this distance. And you can say no prefetch. And if you say just no prefetch without the var, it says don't prefetch anything in this loop. You can also say hash pragma no prefetch of A. It will just suppress the prefetching of A and continue to do the compiler prefetching for B and C. And for B and C, you're basically saying use a prefetch hint of 1 and a distance of 5 vectorized iterations. And there are similar control on the Fortran loops also. So the typical tuning for prefetch, so we have this basic distance option, the op prefetch distance, and you can specify two levels of distances, one for the prefetches from memory to L2, and the second one is for the L2 to L1. So typically the N2 one should be lower than N1, because that's what makes sense. First you want to prefetch into the L2 and then stage, give it a while, and then so that that gets completed, and then you stage it from L2 to L1. So the N1 distance has to be higher than the N2 distance. And these are some examples of what the compiler does for you. So you can specify 64, 32, or if you leave the second distance, then it'll be determined by the compiler. You can say that I am only interested in the second level prefetches, don't issue any first level prefetches, or the vice versa. I'm only interested in the first level prefetches, don't issue in the second level prefetch, if you specify 0 for that part. So typically, if the algorithm is well blocked to fit in the caches, then the prefetching is not that important. But if a lot of the accesses are coming from memory, that's when the prefetching becomes very important. So in many cases, if the compiler doesn't know anything about the trip counts, it would typically use a first level prefetch distance of something like 8 vectorized iterations. For bandwidth bound loops, we have seen cases where increasing this distance increases performance. For example, in stream, the best performance is achieved by using 64,8. So you want to use a distance of 64 vectorized iterations for the first level prefetch. And then this is a generic statement, which is that if you tune turn off the prefetches in a loop, if the performance hurts, that usually means that you can fine tune the prefetch distances and get more performance.
How do you know if the algorithm is well blocked to fit in the L2 cache?
So that is something that hopefully things like VTune can tell you. Like if you know how your algorithm is structured, you know whether the blocking is done or not at a higher level, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that is often a conscious decision done by the programmer. So hopefully the programmer knows whether there is blocking happening at the outer loop level. But
in VTune you can monitor the cache movements.
Yes, the VTune will tell you the cache misinformation. So from that you can derive it also. So this is the set of things that I usually recommend for prefetch tuning. So if you have a loop nest where it looks like prefetching makes an impact, you may want to try these combinations of N1, N2. And you can do it on a per loop basis using pragmas, or you can do it using the distance option at the compilation scope level. There is this another option here, which basically says initial value. So the prefetching done by the compiler, it inserts the prefetch instructions inside the loop, and you are basically prefetching for a future iteration of the loop. So what that ends up doing is that the first few iterations of the vectorized iterations of the loop, there is no prefetching happening. But the compiler can insert some prefetches before you enter the loop. In fact, the compiler does that, but that it limits to up to 6 prefetch instructions per loop. But if you have like 10 accesses inside the loop, and the first 10 iterations you want to prefetch, you can try to do that by increasing that value using the manual. And the other point is the compiler doesn't do prefetches for indirect references by default, because the cost of doing that is higher, because it has to end up doing a lot more address generation and it has to generate a whole bunch of prefetch instructions, so it doesn't do it by default. But if your data from VTune or your own analysis of the application or that data access pattern, you know that most of these indirect accesses are going to different cache lines and they are going to miss in the cache, then you may want to try it. All you need to do is to put a hash pragma prefetch for that array A, and that will trigger the indirect prefetches for that loop inside the compiler. And you can also control it using an option. So here is an example that shows the prefetch distances. So this is a C++ example using a lambda function. So you have a lambda function here, and then the lambda expands into this loop, and you are putting the pragmas associated with that for loop. And there you're basically saying star, which basically means all the accesses inside the loop. And the other interesting point in this particular example is this align value 64. So if you see, the foo8 body has these parameters which are pointers. And this particular request came from, I think, from Los Alamos National Labs. So they have these codes, highly templatized codes, and they know nice properties of all the pointer parameters. They know that it's always aligned by 64. But they don't want to go and put in this hash pragma, vector aligned, and things like that repeatedly for every loop. So what they wanted is a type level control. So we have this extension in the compiler, which basically you can specify using a type def that this real pointer is a aligned 64-byte quantity. It also means that the user has some responsibilities. For example, wherever the real pointer is used, it has to be an aligned 64-byte aligned pointer. So you cannot say like out1 equals out1 plus 3, because you are basically incrementing by 24 bytes, which will make that original out1, which is a 64-byte aligned quantity, into an unaligned quantity. But they were okay with that. So that is a user responsibility. But if you do this, then you basically get aligned accesses everywhere, because the compiler propagates this aligned property throughout using the typedef. So this is how the prefetching report looks like. So it says, so in this particular case, so you have this out1, out2, out3, and then in1 and in2. So there are five different memory accesses. So the compiler generates 10 prefetches, because there are five arrays, two prefetches per array, because one prefetch from memory to L2, the second prefetch from L2 to L1. So 10 prefetches get issued, a few initial prefetches, and then there's more details of the prefetches that are getting issued. So it's using the directive-based hint and the distance and things like that. So this is another example. So you have the inner loop X and the outer loop Y, and the compiler is prefetching for the inner loop X. And if you count carefully, there are like 19 references inside the inner loop. And the compiler doesn't know if X plus NX and X fall in the same cache line, so it assumes they don't. So it treats it as two different cache lines that need to be prefetched. So 19 times 2, 38 prefetches get issued with a distance of 8 vectorized iterations. But from the application programmer's perspective, he knows that the typical trip count of this loop is 192, and you vectorize it by 16, the typical trip count of the vectorized loop is only 12. So if you use a prefetch distance of 8, 2 out of 3 of your prefetches are going to be useless. So if you provide that information to the compiler using this pragma loop count 192, the compiler will use a lower value of this automatically. So this is how practically compiler makes different decisions based on information, trip count information provided by the user. Okay, so now switching to a different optimization inside the compiler. So this is what we call adjacent gather scatter optimization. So this is whenever you have indirect accesses which are gathers inside a loop, and we vectorize the loop, in many cases you have, like, say for example, an array of structure access. So you have X, Y, Z, and then you have A of I dot X, A of I dot Y, A of I dot Z. So even though each axis is actually a gather, but across the gathers, they are actually in the same cache line. So the compiler, the recent compilers in the 15.0 and 16.0, tries to recognize this pattern. And instead of generating three gathers, it does a bunch of unit-sided loads plus a set of shuffles in the registers, so that you don't end up with too many gathers in the generated code. You end up with hopefully cheaper operations, which are unit-sided loads plus shuffles. So that is a basic, and there is a variant of this even for indirect accesses. The example that I gave is the, so there are more examples coming up. So that is a basic idea. So you replace a series of gathers with a series of vector loads of contiguous elements followed by a shuffle sequence. And we basically, we have some simple forms of this are already working in the 15.0 compiler. There are many more cases handled in 16.0. This will be particularly useful for KNC, KNL, and Skylake when it arrives. So this is the simple example using the strided loads. So you have a 4i loop, and you have four different accesses. They're actually contiguous, but if you vectorize each load one at a time, they're actually gathers, because they are strided loads. They're not contiguous. They're not unit strided. So if this is just showing the opt report example. So I compile this with the KNC option at O2. And the left-hand side is a data size is floating single position, and the right-hand side is double position. And the report basically looks something like this. So it says that when I compile for Mike, the adjacent sparse rider loads are not optimized. So the compiler recognized the pattern, but it didn't have an optimized sequence to generate for that pattern, so it ended up generating gathers anyway. So if you see this particular message, you can let us know if it happens in an important hotspot for your loop. We can try to improve it, because all we need to do is to figure out the optimized sequence for that particular pattern and enhance the compiler. The design space is very large. That's why we cannot do it as an algorithm. This is like a case-by-case addition. We have already handled quite a few cases, but if there are other things that you want us to handle, let us know. And this is the axis optimized. It'll look like this. So it says that the adjacent sparse rider loads are optimized for speed. So it clearly tells you the properties of the adjacent gather pattern. There are eight elements, the eight vector elements. There are three of these, the three gathers. So if you, 1, 2, 3, the data D, there are three axes. And you are vectorizing for 512 bits for double position. So there are eight, vector length is eight, and more such details. So in the generated code, in the unoptimized case, the four gathers remain as gathers if you look at the assembly. So the assembly for a gather sequence on KNC looks like this. The two gather instructions and a loop makes the gather sequence for a single gather load on KNC. That's how the assembly will look like. But the code generator was not able to generate a more efficient sequence. But if you look at the three gather sequence, got changed into a bunch of unit strider loads, and then there is a shuffle pattern which is not shown here. So this is a real example from the Coral suite of benchmarks. So there are various benchmarks, and then one particular loop looked like this. It's basically doing a Fortran multi-dimensional array, and then you are vectorizing the J loop, but it's not Fortran, it's C, and you basically have this 0, 1, 2 after the J, so that even though you are vectorizing at the J loop, each of them are actually gathers if you do it naively. But the compiler is able to optimize it, and then it basically says that it recognizes a pattern and it generates an optimized sequence for it. And we have an optimized sequence for this particular pattern for all these platforms, whether you are compiling for AVX or AVX2 or Mic or KNL or Skyrim. So this is the AOS case. So you have a structure with three double position elements, and you access it like this. And we are able to generate an optimized sequence for that. So if you look at the code generation optimization report, that's where these kind of messages will appear. This is a counterpart involving indirect accesses. So here, the J is actually a load. And then you have these accesses, which are basically gathers. But the access is happening in such a way that they are actually contiguous. So even in this case, you can convert the three gathers into a set of unit strider loads plus a bunch of shuffles. So we are able to do this particular, this is a case from MiniMD application, and a particular version of MiniMD, and the compiler generates an optimized sequence, and on KNC it gives about 11% improvement. Okay, so I think I have about 15 minutes left, so I'll try to go a little bit faster on some of these remaining slides. I already talked about this earlier. The assumed shape arrays in Fortran, when the compiler C is this. So the parameters A, B, and C are assumed shape arrays, and you're using Fortran 90 array notation here. So the all the extent and dimension info is passed using dope vectors by the compiler, and it gets populated at the call side, and then it gets passed into the callee. So, and there is no packing into a local data structure to get unit strides. So there could be holes and there could be strides for these assumed shape arrays from the caller to the callee. So when it comes to the callee and the compiler is compiling this loop at the callee, the A, B, and C may not, the compiler has to assume that it is not unit strided, but it does versioning to figure out if they are unit strided or not. Because if it is unit strided, you can do efficient unit strided vectorization, which is many times better than doing these gathers and scatters. So how many versions should it create? So the compiler only generates these two versions. The first version, it basically checks if all the arrays are unit strided. If anything is not, it goes to the version 2 and generates gathers and scatters. So if everything is unit strided, everything will look nice.
So when will it know if it's a unit stride or not? Is it at runtime or?
If you know it at compile time, you can put that contiguous attribute in your source code and this whole problem goes away. If you don't, the worst case is if you don't know it and the at runtime, maybe 10 of the arrays are unit stride, but one array is not. And the compiler did versioning and it didn't help anyway because it had to, because of that one array, it had to go to the non-unit strided version. So if you had put the contiguous on the 10 of the arrays, it would have been much better. So this is how the generated code looks like. So it checks with a version check to see if A, B, and C are unit strided, and if it is, then it goes to the version where everything is unit strided in the if part, and then it does this usual P loop and aligning and the kernel loops and the remainder loops. But the else part, basically version 2, is basically gathers and scatters. So this is just showing more details of how the report will look like. So if you see the kernel loop after the multi-version 1, it says that the loop multi-version 4 stride tests on assumed shape arrays. And then the alternate alignment vectorized loop, and this is the remainder loop for the multi-version V1. And the multi-version V2 is using the gathers because it's the non-unit strided version. This is another common problem that we see in many codes, which, like, when you write a loop like this, it's basically mixing different data types. In C, when you write a constant as 1.0, it's actually a double. It's not a float. So when you and when you use sign, it's actually using the double position sign, not the sign f, which is a single position sign f. So if you write it like this, there are implicit conversion operations that get inserted right out of the front end, and the compiler has to vectorize using those converts, keeping them in place. It cannot remove them arbitrarily. So the right way is to do this. And you get an idea when this problem happens by looking at the vectorization report. So these kind of things get reported. So here it says number of FP up converts, number of FP down converts. So if you see this, this is usually a clue. Why I don't see any converts, why should there be any converts inside my hotspot vector loop? And then you look carefully and then correlate it with what the C language requires you. And then you can get some ideas. Basically the type converts you want to avoid inside vector loops. This is about alignment. So when you have a module and you have arrays, the global arrays inside the module, you can specify the nice 64-byte alignment for these arrays in the module itself. And that information gets propagated to all its users. And this is, you can get better performance out of it. The other way to do it is to use the minus align array 64-byte option in Fortran, which basically says that almost all the arrays make them aligned. So this is the example for that. And here, even if you align it to 64 bytes, all you are doing is you are aligning the base pointer of the arrays. The A, B, C, D base pointers get aligned at 64 bytes. Doesn't mean that the A of I, so when you get to this loop, the first axis is to A of low 1. You don't know anything about the alignment of A of low 1. All you know is A of 0 is aligned at 64 bytes, right? So that's where the peeling done by the compiler helps. Because once you peel it for one of these arrays, automatically all the arrays are going to be aligned, because you know that the base pointers are aligned, and you align for the low 1 automatically using the compiler can derive that everything is aligned, and you will get the benefits of that.
So are the arrays that are defined in the modules good candidates to align at 64?
If you're using Fortran, I would strongly encourage you to use this option. That automatically aligns everything, almost all the arrays. This option is available only on Fortran. It has no counterpart in C. But you're right. If you cannot use it, then you can do it using the module.
I don't understand. Say if that the zero aligned, then why low one could be not aligned?
So it's you're allocating space for the array A, right? Uh-huh. And there are 1,000 elements of this array. So all you're saying at the allocation point is align this array allocation at 64 bytes. You are allocating a contiguous chunk, and the starting point is aligned at 64 bytes. A of 0 is aligned at 64 bytes. A of 8 is aligned at 64 bytes. A of 16 is aligned at 64 bytes. Anything in between is not starting at a aligned cache location. Since you don't know the value of low of 1, it could be any value, right? You cannot assume that the A of low 1 is aligned at 64 bytes.
If A is real, I mean the double precision real, then I don't see why they could be unaligned.
This is because of the address arithmetic. So when you have A of low 1, the address arithmetic says that it is the base pointer A plus low 1 times 8. Mm-hmm. If the base pointer is aligned at 64 bytes, you can use modulo arithmetic to figure out what is the condition you need to get the entire address expression aligned at 64 bytes. Just aligning the A of 0 just tells you about that base pointer. It doesn't tell you about the remaining parts of this address expression.
So if I do align, do the flag align array 64 byte, then is the all elements of A aligned at 64 bytes?
No. You cannot align all. All it means is the base pointer is aligned. Yeah. Because we are not changing the size of the element type. It is still 8 bytes.
Right.
Each element of A is still 8 bytes.
There are gaps in between A0 and A1. It's just 8.
No, that, yeah, you don't want to do that, right? Yeah. if you look at the previous example, so you can see after you do the peeling, all the accesses are aligned. And the compiler is automatically doing it for you based on the information that the base pointers are aligned.
What's the default?
The default is whatever is the element type alignment, so 8-byte alignment. So it's not going to align at 64 bytes for you. So I have about 5 minutes left. So this is an example using the vector elemental function. So you have a call site at the top, a for loop, I loop, which has a call to a function, and the function body has another loop, but the function body itself, we have made it a vector function. And again, the same thing, you have to apply the properties carefully for the parameters. So here, since the start and the end are the same across all the vector lanes, you make it uniform. And the vel x, vel y, vel z, these are basically pointers, and the base pointers. It's basically linear, basically because of the plus psi at the call site, they are changing in a unit strided fashion. So that's why you make them linear. Because if you consider the relationship between the address difference between consecutive vector lanes, they will be unit strided. So that's what this means. So this is a compressed idiom loop. So typically, when for this K1 loop, we cannot vectorize it because there is a store using an index that is getting updated inside a condition. So this index 0 is a nonlinear induction variable. It's not changing in every iteration. It's only getting updated inside a condition. So this makes it not vectorizable on any generation before KNC. But starting with KNC and KNL and Skylake, we will be able to vectorize it. And this is what we call the compressed idiom. So you can use the VPack store instruction in the compiler to generate it. And it's a good thing that we can vectorize it because it goes from no vectorization to vectorization and you get nice benefits. Okay, I'm going to skip this loop. It's an example. So this is another optimization inside the compiler, which we call predicate optimization. Basically, if you have a condition that is using the loop index, or this is one kind of thing that we can handle, or it could be a loop invariant condition, so then you can do a split like this and get rid of the condition inside the innermost loops. And that usually leads to better vectorization and better performance. So this is another example. So if you have I equals wall, then basically the compiler has to generate three different regions of code, and it's doing iteration splitting to do this. And this gets reported in the loop optimization report. It will say something like, condition at line 15 hoisted from loop at line 13 or something like that. So just a few words on the MCD RAM support that we have in the Fortran compiler. So you can specify this fast mem attribute on your allocatable arrays to put that array on the MCD RAM, fast memory in KNL. And basically the compiler, so when you do the allocate of that array, automatically the Fortran compiler will generate calls through the Fortran runtime library to this POSIX, HPW POSIX memalign and HPW free. So this is an example. So you have allocatable arrays A, B, C, and you're putting the fast mem attribute on those. So this is another example. So you have a derived data type, F block, and inside that you have two arrays, work1 and work2, and you can control which one you want to keep it in the MCD RAM, which one not. So if you apply the fastmem attribute only on the work1, when the work1 gets allocated, that will end up in the high bandwidth memory, and the other one will not. Okay. So I think I have like 2-3 slides, basically review sheets. I'm not going to go through this in detail, but just some key things that to remember by just when you're doing performance analysis. This may come in handy. Check whether, like, you know, are you using the right options? Are you maximizing the unit stride accesses in your outer loops? Are you aligning the data? Always study the opt report output. Look at whether a significant runtime is being spent in the peel loop or the remainder loop. Are you able to pad your arrays and get improved performance with the assumed safe padding option on KNC? If you have bandwidth bound loops, can you put the pragma vector align non-temporal to generate streaming stores? If you have any conditions inside your vector loops, if you are able to remove them, you may get better performance. You can also provide a built-in expect hint to the compiler if condition. So if you have a if condition that is rarely taken, if you can say built-in expect of that condition, comma, zero, which basically gives the compiler the information that that condition is rarely taken. And it may vectorize it differently based on that. So I think we talked about this. Vectorize at the right level using the SIMD pragma. Try to see if array notation can help in some cases. SIMD enabled functions can help in some cases. We saw a few examples of those. Try to see if outer loop vectorization makes sense. As much as possible, unit-sided vectorization is the best. Even F90 can be used for that. For advanced optimization options, so in some cases, you can, especially if you're a complex data type, use the FP model fast equals 2, which basically enables this complex limited range option. If you're running on KNC, the basic FIMF domain exclusion equals 15. That basically gets enabled as part of the FP model fast equals 2. A lot of the math functions will be faster with that option, but the precision will change. So it's always a trade-off. So similar controls for precision, divide, square root, transcendentals. So there are big articles written on how to, what each of these mean in more detail, but this is some idea. So you can find a lot more Fortran specific tips in this article, and it goes into great detail on different kinds of arrays and what kind of vectorization you get from each kind of Fortran array and the options. And there's a lot of details in this first link. So if ever you get the time, please try to take a look at that. All this presentation is coming from material out there, and there are a lot more examples there. I think that's all I had. Sorry, I ran over a little bit. Any questions?
So, for those, those pragma or those directives, so I'm wondering, in terms of the code portability, so is the compiler vendors, are the compiler vendors, talking to each other to develop certain kind of standard?
So they come in two different basic varieties, right? So for example, the SIMD pragma and the OMP declare SIMD, they're already part of OpenMP 4.0 standard, and we are actually trying to push it into C++ standard and things like that. So that is already covered.
What about the loop count?
Those are not. So those are Intel specific.
And FastMem is also.
FastMem is also Intel specific, yes. So that one, some compilers have similar controls. For example, the IBM compiler has some controls.
Mm-hmm.
But each one is controlling very specific. The good part is it's a pragma, so if the compiler doesn't like it, it'll just treat it as an OOP. But that's something, I don't think there is any effort to unify it across compilers. The only effort is to make it part of this in some standard. And there is some activity in that direction in OpenMP to consider loop blocking pragmas. That's under discussion in 4.1 and beyond, in 5.0 actually. But beyond that, I'm not aware of other activities. Any other questions?
So once again, another question about whether the slides are going to be available.
Sure, I can leave it with you.
Okay, so I guess the answer is yes, and we'll put the slides up
on the website.
On the website. Is there a website for this event?
Not quite yet.
Okay. So
NERSC training.
When you go to the NERSC training website, in the next day or so, you'll see a link for this event, and we'll put up the slides there.
I'm presuming the video worked, we'll try and do something with it.
And presuming if the video worked, we'll have it up too.
Just to follow up on the alignment of the 64-byte alignment, what's the cons of doing this? You said, oh, it's advantageous to use it, but when you don't want to use it, the alignment, why wouldn't you want your data not to be not aligned, to be misaligned?
Because if you may have to insert padding, right? So for example, if you have a structure and with three fields, and you're not going to have everything aligned for the start of the structure unless you insert padding. So basically, it's a memory trade-off, right? And there is no way, like for example, in C, the C language doesn't let the compiler to automatically change these things. And like in some cases, like so, and many times the malloc is done by the user. The compiler doesn't trap a malloc and increase the size to automatically align it or things like that. That's handled by the whatever malloc does. Mm-hmm. So that's why the responsibility is kind of split between the user and the compiler. So in C, for example, you can get aligned malloc. You can use mmalloc instead of malloc. And then you get malloc. So that is the way you would align your data structures with 64 bytes. So why wouldn't you always do it? It's basically when you worry about space wastage, that would be the significant.
Okay. Yeah.
Because if you do it blindly, it can cause put pressure on memory bandwidth. Because if your structure is only 24 bytes and you are inserting a padding of 8 bytes always, that's bad.
Yeah.
Question about the FP model, fast equal to 2.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it contains that prec div, dash div. The division, you change it to multiplication.
The so FP model fast equals to doesn't contain that. The minus fast does it. It's a slightly different one.
Okay.
These are two separate things. But
okay, so
what's the question?
Yeah, my question is, so with all these, you know, optimization, I mean, compiler manual always warn us, so the precision may change. So
yes.
Is there any way, I mean, for user, if I used this option at one time, can I tell something went wrong or not? I mean, compiler, that is it possible for compiler give any warning, like if the error kind of big and sort of thing?
No, that,
yeah.
That.
So in reality, so how we
so,
can
so
tell if we use it or not?
That has to be reasoned at the algorithmic level.
Algorithmic.
So from the algorithmic point of view, what is the convergence properties of your algorithm? What is the precision that you require? Do you really need IEEE precision, or can you live with something slightly lower than that? That's the answer. And if you go to this site here, there is a section on advanced optimizations, and at the top level, there are two or three articles, big articles, that deal with this particular topic. It gives you a lot of details.
First link, right?
Yeah, the first link takes you to a big page with tons of information,
mm-hmm.
and it's organized as chapters. One of those chapters is advanced optimizations.
Mm-hmm.
And under that, it talks about this FP precision options and the trade-offs. And it has a lot of information about what it does. And there is no simple answer. Like it's anytime you change the optimization level, if you compile it O2 to O3 to O0, you are changing some of these things because the defaults are different. If you go from Haswell to Ivy Bridge to KNC, you are changing things. If you are running from one processor to another, so the only thing, if you are totally worried about IEEE precision, then you are limited. But if you are not, and you can live with these differences. Like if you have a condition that it has to be bit reproducible across architectures, across optimizations, then your options are limited. But in many cases, people make trade-offs knowing that, okay, I'm going to trade off with that because I'm getting so much better performance. And that is acceptable. So it has to be a conscious decision. And compiler cannot help you because at the runtime, it will just show up as a different number. Compiler doesn't know what is right, what is wrong.
Just a quick check, confirm. So the FastMem directive is available in the production release,
yes.
Not in the beta release 2016 or update.
It's even available in the 15.0 product.
What is the current compiler version?
So the 15.0 is our currently shipping product version. And the 16.0 is currently in beta. The 16.0 is the official name for that is this compiler 2016. 2016 compiler means 16.0. It will officially get released around August or September of this year.
I was just checking this, what's new for the beta 2016 update 1, and it mentioned about fast mem. That's why I'm confused. That's new in the beta.
It just means that we ended up documenting it only now, but it's already supported in 15.0.
Thank you.
Oh, one last simple question. So if I, in the compile line, if I indicate several optimization options, but there are some conflict or overlap part. So let's say if I use O3 at the beginning and use O0 at the end, what I get? I mean, the
order
matters.
You will most likely get O0. So
the last one counts, right?
It depends on the option combinations. Usually when things like that happen, the driver gives out a warning or a remark, so
which
watch out for those. But usually it's left to right and the last one gets precedence.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so let me try to
so you
make the slides.
Hi, Jack.
Yeah,
thank
you.
I think I do know how to remove this thing.
Oh, really?
Yeah, there is an offset here. We can't remove, but we can put it to a synchron. Well, I don't see different. See, I see different one. So here there is an option like to fit into viewer, but this one doesn't give me that. Maybe they are different. I'm in my part. That's weird. I thought I figured out.
Oh, thank you.
Okay.
That was really good. Thanks.
Useful. Wait, at a certain point, you showed the cache blocking source code. You said, did you say we can see this code or not?
Let me.
See, what I wanted is, does compiler output the generated source code?